operating. So once we have some news on that, then we can start. Okay, welcome everyone, and sorry again for that slight delay, which was due to the setup of the video screen. So this is the workshop on broadband access and consumer rights. Hopefully you're in the right spot. My name is Jeremy Malcolm, and I work for Consumers International. My co-organiser is Charlie Lewis in the middle there, and his team behind the scenes. Charlie is a senior lecturer, researcher and consultant at the Link Centre in Johannesburg, and you'll have the opportunity to hear more about his work from him later. And I'll introduce the other panellists as we get to them, but I will say that it is an excellent panel in that it represents the full range of stakeholders involved in broadband and consumer protection, ranging from consumer groups to network operators, academia, content providers and regulators. So I think this will be a very productive session which illuminates an area which has been surprisingly overlooked in the IGF discussions before now. Often I feel that discussions around access at the IGF seem to assume that once a consumer has internet access, it's job done. Whereas in fact for regulators, consumer groups and providers, it's only the beginning. So the purpose of this workshop is to explore how to ensure that access is provided in a manner that respects the eight consumer rights, which include the right to be informed, the right to choose, the right to be heard, the right to redress, and the right to consumer education. So whilst we haven't confined the panellists to addressing specific topics, questions which may come up during the course of this workshop might include What are the consumer protection issues that consumers are reporting around the world? How can these be quantified and reported to consumers, regulators, and providers? What are the best practices for telecommunications regulators in upholding consumer rights? What work is being done to set global norms around consumer protection in ICT services? And what systemic changes are being asked of providers, and what are their perspectives on these? So before we get going, I have to apologize for something. Firstly, I had planned to give you all a copy of a new book that my organization, Consumers International, has just published on broadband and consumer protection, titled Holding Broadband Providers to Account. But my bag was lost en route to Baku, and that's the same reason why I'm wearing jeans rather than a suit before you today. The good news is that the bag has been found, so I expect that copies of that book will be available tomorrow in the IGF village area, together with some posters. So I would encourage you to check that area tomorrow and pick up your copy of the book. If there is time after all the other panelists have spoken, then I may take the opportunity to make a brief presentation of my own, which gives a flavour of what you would have been able to read in the book, to the extent that it's not covered by the other panelists. But you can find copies of these books that Charlie's organisation has published, and he'll tell you some more about those when he speaks. So, without further ado, I'm going to move on to the first panellist. We've asked them to speak for about 8 minutes, and that should leave about half an hour at the end for open discussion and questions. So, Charlie Lewis, whom I've briefly introduced already, his areas of interest include ICT sector policy and regulation, universal service and access, consumer protection regulation, the internet, labour, work and ICT, and business process outsourcing. He's lectured and presented widely on a number of ICT policy, regulation and development issues, and has undertaken research in a number of areas including the internet, call centres, e-learning and universal access and service. So, Charlie, can you point me to which of the presentations is yours? Okay, let's see if I can find that one. Must be this one, I think.
Thank you, Jeremy, and thank you very much to Consumers International for approaching us and giving us the opportunity to participate on this panel with them. My name is Charlie Lewis. My details are there, and you've heard a bit about me from Jeremy. I'm going to start off, if you can just go slide down, Jeremy. Talking a little bit about how we came to be involved in this process, it grew out of some research that we did, funded by the IDRC of Canada, with which we interacted and did some work with Consumers International. It was run in a couple of phases. The first phase produced the purple report that you see on the top right of the screen there, looking at consumer protection in the telecommunications and internet space in particular, at three countries, Kenya, Senegal, and South Africa. The second phase of the research moved on to involve five member states of the Association of Regulators of East and Central Africa, that's ARECEA, and produced really three concrete and substantial outputs. The first was an examination of international best practice in relation to consumer protection in the telecommunications space. I think it's quite a useful little report. That's the middle one on the right-hand side. Probably could usefully be updated and extended more into the internet and the broadband space. Its main center of gravity is in telecommunications issues. We then looked at consumers in a range, in the five countries, target countries in ARECEA, interacted with regulators and made a series of recommendations to the regulators, which is the document on the bottom right-hand side there. mainly looking at telecommunications and mainly looking at mobile telecommunications issues, because that's the center of gravity, that's the major component of consumers of telecommunication services in Africa. Finally, out of that project, we produced an updated set of consumer protection guidelines for the Association of Regulators, which were adopted at their AGM at Victoria Falls, Harare, a little while ago, and I believe should finally have been out very recently. I haven't seen them yet. So, set of guidelines for regulators in dealing with consumer protection issues in the broad ICT space, telecommunications, broadcasting, internet, broadband. Four issues I think really came out of the research, and I'm sure fellow panelists will pick up many of those issues as well. One of them is the need to ensure that consumers have a voice, have a channel, have a vehicle, have processes and procedures through which they can raise their issues and interact with policy and regulation. Secondly was the need to ensure that consumers have a proper choice in terms of services, types of services, quality of service, price of service, etc. Thirdly, the need to ensure that there are properly mandated, properly structured processes to deal with consumer issues and consumer complaints and quality of service issues. And then finally, the need to ensure provision of information to consumers in the broad ICT space. Thank you. Next slide, Jeremy. So in approaching the workshop today, I went through and I looked at some of the questions that Jeremy had raised. And the first one, I guess, is what kind of issues do the consumers of broadband products and services face that need to be addressed? I think firstly one needs to start off by saying that this set of issues needs to be properly researched, properly quantified, properly measured, and there's really insufficient work in that space currently, and that involves research that is both top-down, from the top level down, from statistics that you can get from the providers, the operators, the regulators, etc., but also needs to be bottom-up research that actually works from the consumers and from their perceptions of the issues that arise. Secondly, that research needs to be both quantitative. It's very easy to look at quantitative quality of service, you know, things like a packet delay, bandwidth, throughput, etc., etc. But they also need to be a subjective set of issues, consumer perceptions and consumer views of the issues that they face. Secondly, I don't think that the issues are dramatically different for broadband. There obviously are qualitative shifts, but there's nothing dramatically different from the kinds of issues broadly that consumers face in the telecommunications space generally. And for us in Africa, I think there are three that arise in particular, and they arise in particular in relation to the work that we did looking at mobile, but they also come up, I think, in relation to broadband. The first is ensuring that consumers have access to a service, that they have access to broadband services. In many countries in Africa, broadband is developing relatively quickly, but still off a very, very low base. So broadband penetration is very, very low. In my own country, for example, 65% of the population does not have access to the internet, let alone broadband. So obviously broadband penetration issues are much lower and tend to be very low in Africa. And broadband in Africa in particular is very likely to be 3G through the mobile infrastructure. There are very few countries in Africa, my own excluded, that have anything by way of a substantial fixed line infrastructure through which ADSL access may be provided. Obviously there are people working in fiber to the home in South Africa, but predominantly for consumers in Africa, their access to broadband is going to be access to mobile broadband, firstly. The second set of issues, and they rise again in relation to mobile telecoms, is the quality of service that the consumers experience. In relation to broadband, Those would be questions of things like bandwidth, for example. You have providers advertising a particular bandwidth, and that's generally speaking not what the consumers get, high levels of contention. And so what they're really advertising is what would be the maximum bandwidth you would get at 2 a.m. in the morning when everyone else is asleep. So the bandwidth itself is an issue. Things like data volumes come up as well. A lot of the broadband is capped, and you get services that provide you with 2 gigabytes a month, 1 gigabyte a month, 10 gigabyte a month, and they're different kind of pricings. There is some uncapped ADSL in my own country, but data, the quantity of data and the price of data is a second issue. Thirdly is the price of the service, the costs that you pay for the services, and these vary very widely across countries in Africa. In my own country, we're experiencing a plethora of arrival of undersea cables. There are a number of providers very active in the country providing fiber infrastructure, wholesale fiber infrastructure across the country. There are a number actually in the region providing wholesale fiber access. And so the price of the service is falling, but in many countries in Africa it remains very, very high. It's often multiples of the average monthly earnings of citizens in those particular countries. So pricing is a particular issue in relation to broadband, and particularly in Africa. There are obviously a number of issues that come up in relation to contracts that people sign. Consumers are often not aware of the contracts, what's in the contracts, what the implications for them are, how to enforce the contracts. Billing issues come up quite frequently. In South Africa, one of the relatively sort of recent consumer issues is the expiry dates on prepaid broadband. And I know I've tried to take on the regulator, I've tried to take on the operators. You buy a 2 gigabyte package, and once you activate it, at the end of 60 days, whether or not you've used the 2 gigabytes, it's gone. So you might have an unused 1 gigabyte. The regulator has taken a view that should be available to you according to the law, which suggests it should be for 3 years. But they're dealing with a consumer commission in the country which is understaffed, incompetent, and unable to enforce that. And so the operators are simply dodging the issues. It's been reported in the press, but nothing has been resolved. So contracts and billing are issues. The next two issues I raise because I think they would be important issues, but they haven't really been researched and not a great deal has been written about them. The first of those is issues related to things like mobile commerce, sales over the internet, authentication of service providers, trust of transactions, etc. Net neutrality will obviously come up as an issue here at this particular conference, and that's likely to be an issue, and there may be a range of others. And obviously research would need to be undertaken to identify, quantify, and prioritize those issues. So those are some of the issues that broadband consumers may face. Related to that is, what is it that policymakers can do in response to those issues? And I think there would be a couple of issues or a couple of interventions that would be important. The first one is to ensure that there is a proper legal mandate for regulation to protect consumers, that it's a requirement of the ICT sector regulation to intervene in support of consumers in their public interest mandate. It needs to be clearly written in the law. Secondly, I think that that mandate should not be overly narrow and prescriptive. We had a Consumer Protection Act in South Africa. At one point, there were very large lists of issues in that particular piece of legislation. And if they are too narrow and too limiting, they don't allow the regulator to evolve issues and evolve interventions as the sector moves on, as convergence advances, as technologies evolve. They don't allow the regulator to be innovative and responsive to consumer issues as they arise. Thirdly, and I think this is critical in areas where there is co-jurisdiction with other regulators, where other regulators also have consumer protection responsibilities, a framework for dealing with that co-jurisdictions clearly needs to be set out in the legislation so that you don't have two different regulators each saying, well, it's your problem, no, it's my problem, arguing over how to manage that co-jurisdiction. In South Africa, we have a consumer commission, and there's a clear set of co-jurisdiction issues between their legislation and their mandate and the legislation and mandate that governs the ICT sector regulation. In relation to banking, m-commerce, for example, the banking regulator would have co-jurisdiction. And so those sets of relationships and issues need to be managed. And finally, you need to make sure that the regulator is properly resourced with human resources, with money, so that they are able to take on the operators, take on the providers, and properly enforce their consumer protection mandate. Next slide, please. What can regulators do? A couple of issues, and some of them are dealt with in the international best practice reports that are lying on the tables over here. Firstly, maybe not necessarily in order of priority, regulators need to survey consumers. They need to go out and they need to do large-scale surveys of consumers on a regular basis, identifying what the consumers' views about the various issues that they face, the problems that they face, the things that they are complaining about. They need to identify their views as consumers of the various providers, the quality of the providers, and thirdly, they need to look at their own regulatory effectiveness. How do consumers assess the work that they are doing? And regulators often don't do that, often assume that consumers know about them, and our research suggested that in most countries in Africa, the overwhelming majority of consumers are not even aware of the existence of the regulator, let alone of their consumer protection function. So surveying consumers is important. Secondly, it's very important to establish codes of conduct, quality of service standards, consumer protection standards to make these mandatory for operators. And yes, they may be self-regulatory standards, but they need to be in place. The operators need to be forced to sign up to them or required to sign up to them, and they need to be communicated to consumers. And regulators should make sure that the operators are the ones that have to, and the providers are the ones that have to communicate those standards. Thirdly, the need to establish proper complaints procedures and make sure that consumers are aware of how they deal with a complaint, where they file a complaint, and the procedures need to include escalation channels. What that means really is that the first port of call for any consumer complaint needs to be the operator or the provider themselves. Unless, as a regulator, you plan to open an enormous call center with large numbers of staff, you need to make sure that consumers work through the operators first and then come to you when they don't get satisfaction. Fourthly, you need to make sure that operators report on complaints, report to you as a regulator on a regular annual or six-monthly basis, what kinds of complaints, break them down in terms of numbers, and give you the information as a regulator that will allow you to analyze the results so that you can identify issues and undertake interventions where those are necessary. I put the next point in because I think it's underestimated by regulators. You need to have a Facebook page as a regulator. You need to have somebody who's posting things on Twitter, and you need to use those particular channels for picking up consumer protection issues. And they're going to become increasingly important as broadband and as consumer access to those platforms increases. Next is very important is communicating the information, making sure that the consumers know what's happening, and that may be through your own website, it may be through press releases, it may be through engaging the broadcast media, and it may be through the social media that I've mentioned already. And then finally, as a regulator, you need to be proactive. You need to try and move ahead of the issues as they evolve as much as you possibly can. Finally, before Jeremy pulls the plug on me for time, what can consumers do? Well, one of the interesting things that is happening in the internet broadband space at the moment is consumers exploiting social media and the internet. For example, in South Africa, there was a site, and it still exists as far as I know, called Helcom, which took the name of the fixed line provider and used a punning joke on it. They were Telkom. the website became Helcom, and the website actually became a channel and a vehicle for people to raise issues, voice complaints, and talk about the poor quality of service they were getting from the incumbent provider. Some of you may know, and it's not broadband related issues, may have come across the United Breaks the Guitars Facebook, well it was actually on YouTube, it wasn't on Facebook. A guitarist who traveled around, put his two guitars, tried to check them into the cabin with him, United Airlines wouldn't allow it, put it in hold baggage and pulverized the guitars, and then wouldn't refund him afterwards. And so what he did was he made a video about how badly United Airlines treated their customers, United Breaks Guitars, and the video went viral on YouTube, and he had United Airlines chasing him down, trying to pay him money to remove the video. He refused, and in fact the people that contacted him as well were the guitar, the company that provided the guitars, because they got sales, an upsurge in sales of their guitars. So that kind of viral interaction from consumers often works very well. In South Africa, we have a website called hellopeter.com where consumers can voice complaints, and you often get a quicker response going through those social media than you do through the standard complaints channels. Because it's public, providers are often worried about things going viral and snowballing, and so they have people monitoring those channels and responding to the complaints as quickly as possible. From my own union, trade union background, organize as consumers. It's very important for consumers to get together, talk together, lobby issues together. And that would allow you to identify the issues affecting you as consumers and profiling them. And then finally, it's important for consumers to be able to interface with policy, the policymakers in the previous slide, and to interface with the regulators and to have input into the kinds of things that the regulators are doing to make sure that consumers' voices are heard in those particular processes. So that gives us a little bit of a kind of introduction to the session today. Thank you, Jeremy, and over to you and the fellow panelists. Thank you.
Thank you very much. I guess that was a little over 8 minutes, so I'll ask the subsequent panelists to stick a bit more closely to their time, but that was very good, and I would like to let you all know about something that Consumers International is doing on social media as well. We have a mock ISP which has its own Facebook and Twitter pages, which is called iStall. So if you go to www.facebook.com/iStall.net or twitter.com/iStallnet, one word without the dot, you can check out some of the tweets and Facebook posts that this mock ISP has been making. And the desire is to stimulate consumers into interacting with this fake ISP as a way of drawing attention to its bad practices, which we're campaigning about. So thanks again, Charlie. And I'm going to move on to Sam. It's iStall, I-S-T-A-L-L. If you can't find it, just find me later and I'll give you the correct address. So, Sam, we'll move on to our next panelist. he says I can skip the introduction, but just briefly, he's in the Directorate of Science, Technology and Industry for the OECD. And he also has been involved in the OECD is the sole ministerial on the future of the internet economy and the follow-up from that. So I'll just bring up his presentation.
This one, yeah. So, good morning, everyone. I guess this cuts off when you start speaking into the own microphone, so I hope you can all hear me. Jeremy's brought up the presentation. Actually, Charlie, I think, has made a lot of the points I wanted to make, and I found myself agreeing with a lot of what he said, in fact, most of it. The presentation I see is a bit hard to read on the screen, so no doubt Jeremy will make it available afterwards, because at the end of it has some links to where you can get further information on OECD work in this area. I can hardly read the screen myself, so bear with me as we go through this. I thought I'd start by telling you a very quick story, seeing Charlie did save me some time on the presentation because I'm going to skip through a lot of it. Yesterday in Australia was our Melbourne Cup Day, which is our biggest horse race in Australia. It basically stops the country. One of the states has a holiday, Parliament stops, everyone stops and listens to this horse race for about 2 or 3 minutes. So I want you to imagine that all the horses are at the gate and you get a text message, and it's from the largest telephone company. You probably don't pay a lot of attention to it, but what that text message was about, if you read the fine print in it, was actually doubling the price of international telephone calls. So the reason I make this point, and there'd be many stories like this, is even when you seek out all the examples, it's very hard to predict how the market will react in these sorts of situations. In Australia's case, and this is one point I would add to what Charlie said, is that we've just gone from 4 operators to 3 operators. So I think competition was diminished by that, and I think this is one of the outcomes of that. So when we're talking about consumer protection, we should never underestimate the power of competition in getting companies to react in the right way for the objectives we want. Now, just quickly to go through the presentation, and as I said, Charlie made many of the points. We have what we call a consumer policy toolkit, and this can be applied to potato chips or silicon chips. It doesn't matter. It's a set of principles that consumer authorities can apply when dealing with these issues. And at the end of last year, we decided to apply the toolkit to the communications area, which is the area I work in. And I can hardly read the screen, but basically the problems that were identified in this area were pretty much what Charlie identified. If I could go to the next slide. So what were the issues? All the ones that Charlie identified, I won't go through the list, but just to give one example, and I'll probably just give one example from each slide. I've only got about 5 of them. Let's just take fine print, for example. One of my bugbears with when I go to telecommunication operators' sites, and I do it a lot because we do a lot of price comparisons, is the amount of fine print that I have to read to actually determine what the offer is. And I'm an expert in this stuff. This is what I do and what I've done for 20 years, and I find it very hard to determine what some of the offers are. And it really bugs me with some of the fine print when some of the fonts chosen are actually below the regular ones that you get with Microsoft. So you actually have to seek out the size of the font, and it can be below the lowest one offered. So I sit there and think, someone actually deliberately went out and made the font even smaller than the lowest option that's available. So I think there's a lot of improvement that could be made there. If I go to the next slide, Jeremy. And actually what I'm doing in this is going through some of the questions that Jeremy raised. So first one was how to identify the issues. Second one is how can this be quantified? Charlie's mentioned some of them. You can do market surveys. I perhaps use that as an example. The problem with that is they can be expensive. So for consumer authorities and regulators, that can be an expensive way to do it. Obviously, there's complaints, but again, sometimes the complaint data is very hard to interpret. I could go on giving examples in that area, but I think Charlie's covered that. If I go to the third, not the next slide, but the third question there, and I'm reading on Jeremy's computer here, is how are these issues being addressed? What we suggest at the OECD is a gradiated approach. So starting off with obviously things like consumer education and so forth, right up to fines. And fines can be effective. Regulators do have those powers in some countries, but again, they could be challenged in the courts and so forth. But they can send a message to the market if regulators identify something that's very serious. Could I go to the next slide, please? Okay, the fourth question was about global norms. Again, I'm afraid you can't really list this, but this is a list of guidance that has been provided by OECD work over the last couple of years. This can be applied to communications markets. I haven't got time to go through all these either council recommendations or other instruments that the OECD uses, but for example, one might include making sure that consumers are able to switch effectively between operators. I think that's very important. And you really have to ensure that competition is effective. So it's not just having a number of operators in the market, but making sure consumers can switch and take advantage of the different offers that are available. Could I go to the next slide, please? What should providers be focusing on? I've got a list of suggestions there, some of which, again, Charlie's already covered, but cooperation, dialogue between all the stakeholders, trying to make the offers more transparent. I come back to this issue. Transparency is so important in the offers that operators put out there. And in, you know, I spend a lot of the time, again, because I do comparisons in the area of broadband, trying to understand the issues. I think it must be enormously difficult for consumers to try and assess the different offers. And the language can be very misleading. It can say things like unlimited, it can say things like flat rates, which aren't actually the case in the way that I would understand those offers as someone who does communication comparisons. And if I could meet my time and go to the last slide. Again, you won't be able to read it here, but there's some links to a whole lot of OECD material, including the things I mentioned, and I will stop there. Thank you.
Thanks very much, Sam. And yes, we will have the presentations up later for those who would like a copy. I'll get the consent of the panellists, but I'm sure none of them will disagree. So it will be at a2knetwork.org/broadband. And once again, if you need another, if you don't get, you didn't get that down, come and see me later and I'll give it to you with my business card. So let's move right along to Viridiana Alamonti. Viridiana graduated in law at the University of Sao Paulo, and she works at the Brazilian Institute for Consumer Defense, or IDEC, with telecommunications and internet as her main issues. She's also a board member of the Brazilian Internet Steering Committee, CGI.br, as one of the representatives of the third sector, and part of the Committee for the Defense of Users of Telecommunications Services, CDUST, in the National Telecommunications Agency. So thank you very much, Viridiana.
Thank you, Jeremy. Thank you for the invitation. Good morning, everyone. And as Jeremy said, I work at a Brazilian consumer organization. And there, we work intensely with telecommunications and internet issues, doing advocacy, researches, campaigns, among other activities. And well, as we know, the transformative potential of broadband internet to empower citizens and to promote social development is a fact and underpins the adoption of strategies to promote universal access to broadband. However, as soon as you have an internet connection or all the required conditions to hire one, other issues come to the fore. The first thing we should stress is the lack of organized information about different plans and services conditions. When you talk about telecommunication services, including broadband ones, it's quite usual to talk about asterisks, hidden links, and information at the bottom of the advertisements. IDEC coordinated the Consumers International Research in the American region. Consumers International Research, Consumers International carried out an international research about the main problems in broadband services, which is the book that Jeremy mentioned earlier. And we coordinated this research in the American region. And one part of the results is in this slide presentation, so I'll place the next one. So these were the partners who made the research in the Americas, and we had a desk research and an online survey. And we had Argentina, Brazil, Chile, Costa Rica, Guyana, Mexico, and United States. And also one part or the online survey or the desk research. We had also Canada and Peru. Please, the next one. In total, we had like 5,000 responses divided in these countries. And please, the next one. And well, we were talking about this ISPs in the most part of the time. This is the major ISPs in the American region. Please, the next one. So here we have a table with problems connecting to the internet. And this question, it was a question in the online survey, and the answers were organized in a gradation that started with serious problems until no problem. And this table, this table took into account the serious problem gradation, the gradation two, and no problems answers. And well, H2 responses also concerned the existence of severe problems, but in a lower degree than the A1. And it's interesting to notice two main problems, that is internet speed. So the highest difference between problem and no problem is internet speed. And also it's the only part that serious problems answer surpasses alone the no problem responses. And also establishing a connection is also a problem that draws attention by the number of problems answers and by the number of no problem responses. Okay, the next one, please. This was about evaluation of internet service providers. In this is number of answers, not a percentage. And we see that most of people think that the service that, that ISPs provide doesn't worth what they pay for it. And especially ISPs connection speed is also a great problem and all the responses. Please, the next one. This is about preventing the change of ISPs. And one interesting thing to notice is that in Latin America, the biggest problem is that no other provider, that the people doesn't have an option. So the people don't have an option. They don't have another provider to switch the service. And after that, we have a minimum term contract to fulfill and a bundled service as a problem to change the ISP. But the competition problem is quite important in Latin America. Please, the next one. So about information problems, we have this this table here. It was the answers about if the people were informed when they saw the offers, if they were informed about this issues, and we can see that, well, it's difficult for me to see here, but even though the persons were informed about price, they weren't informed about any future change in the conditions at the service, like a promotional, the end of a promotional period, and the prices that would be used after that. So information is a really big problem in internet and broadband service. Please, next one. Well, this was the broadband desk research report in Brazil. Please, the next one. It was undertaken in May 2010, but we reviewed the results to the Consumers International report, and it was reviewed the contracts with the five main service providers in Brazil. And the research focuses on unfair contractual terms, also covering misleading advertising, and bad practice, bad enterprises practices. Please, the next one. So we thought that traffic speed variation was often informed in the contract, but not oftenly informed in the websites or by the customer service when we call them. And the clauses exclude or diminish the company responsibility. We had also harmful internet practices, four out of the five companies that were reviewed. have in their contracts the provision of surveillance to protect intellectual property on the web, authorizing themselves to terminate the contract in case an irregularity was detected. We also had commercial advertisements and personal data issues, minimum contract terms also, billing without non-provided services, and many of those were worsened by the lack of information. Please, the next one. So, coming back to quality of service and speed variation, it's important to emphasize that regardless technical issues, explicit information about speed variation are required and easy to provide. And associated with the provision of information, however, I understand that it's crucial to establish regulatory standards related to QoS allied to measurement and redress mechanisms. Brazilian Telecommunications Regulatory Agency approved in October of last year two broad regulations about quality for fixed and mobile broadband, not restricted to QoS, but including mandatory parameters of connection speed, reliability, latency, and jitter. And in the debate, I can bring more information about it. Please, the next one. Thank you.
Thank you very much. So let's move on again to Meredith Whitaker, who is from quite a different background. She's program manager from Google Research. She leads initiatives related to internet measurement, including managing Google's involvement in the Measurement Lab project, which she'll tell you about. In this capacity, she's worked closely with the academic community, policymakers, consumer advocates, and national regulators across the globe to advise on scientifically verifiable broadband measurement and policy. So thank you very much, Meredith.
Thank you, Jeremy. Yeah, that's all true. And I am here as representing both Google Research and the Measurement Lab Consortium, which is not a Google project or program. It is a research consortium, so being clear there. Before I move on, thank you for the invitation, Jeremy, and Consumers International, and thank you for the people here for being here. I think this is a really important issue. So I'm going to go through this. I'm going to be very high level and try to be quick to allow time for questions, I hope. But I would hope that anyone who does have questions here could just come see me afterward, because there's a lot more to talk about here than I'll have time to talk about. So moving on to the next slide. So I think that Charlie's presentation, Sam's presentation, Veridiana's presentation talked a lot about the need to inform consumers. And I think what I'm going to present is something that can really provide a kind of a foundation for that information. The idea that we actually need open, scientific, verifiable data to, you know, substantiate claims that, you know, in the IDEC report, when somebody reports that there is a problem, well, a problem can manifest in one symptom that could have many different potential causes. So figuring out what the cause of that problem is, beginning to look at actual data about where a bottleneck could be causing speeds. Are speeds being throttled? Are there, you know, is there content-specific discrimination, or is there an issue, you know, another issue that can be fixed? But beginning to get verifiable data on what's happening on these networks in order to allow for practical regulatory and, you know, technical action, I think is very important. So the theme here is that consumers deserve to know what's going on with their internet, and the internet is not a simple, easily measurable entity. It is a broad global network with infinite dependencies that have, you know, is incredibly dynamic, and understanding this is going to take new models that revolve around transparency and around the kind of collaborative, multi-stakeholder, to use the term of the day, model that supports and needs to continue to support the growth of the internet. So from there, moving on to the next slide. I think I covered this, but really, to be accountable, measurement that provides this kind of data needs to be open. It needs to be scientifically verifiable, which means rooted in the scientific process. The scientific process means that anyone with the expertise can look at the data and then can replicate the results, can understand the methodologies, can understand, you know, the way this data was achieved and what it's actually saying. a small change in a measurement methodology in, you know, a line of code can produce, you know, vast differences in data. So you need, when you have a number that says you are getting, you know, 100 megabit speed, and congratulations for you if you're getting that, you need to understand that, you know, how was that number achieved? Are we doing multi-threaded or single-threaded TCP measurement, right? And that's just one variable among many that can affect that. So to actually be able to do, you know, real change at a technical level that can be enacted at a regulatory level, we need this information. And so I'm going to talk briefly about the Measurement Lab Research Consortium, which is, you know, one of the entities that I'm here representing. The Measurement Lab Research Consortium was founded by a group of researchers, including Vint Cerf, a number of years ago, basically to address the challenge that good data on the way networks work was very hard to come by. The measuring at internet scale is difficult, it is expensive, and it is outside of the means of even the most well-funded research lab. So we saw researchers lacking this data, which meant the state of the art for understanding and growing and really caring for the internet was lagging behind. And when that lags behind, it meant regulators didn't have this information. They were left in the dark in terms of making these important decisions. It meant consumers, when they were sold a package with a certain speed, you know, there's no way to know, right? I don't actually know what 100 megabits looks like. I know what it looks like when YouTube loads quickly. I know what it looks like when I go to Facebook and it loads quickly. But these are abstract terms that need to be rooted in real data. And that's, you know, that's what Measurement Lab was trying to address in an open way. So you have researchers accessing this data, you have it available for regulators, and you have it openly available for anyone in the public at a level they can understand. There's a website there if you're interested. So moving to the next slide. So quickly on the MLAB model, and I think that I'm not going to spend that much time here because all of this is on the site and it gets technical very quickly. The way to ensure open measurement, this isn't just open sourcing a line of code. This is making sure that all of the servers collecting the data around the globe, we are, you know, Measurement Lab is a global consortium, it's a global project, making sure that those servers are consistent so that one testing instance is collecting data in the same way as the next one and those can be responsibly compared. Then making sure that the tools that are doing the data collection are open source so that you can actually look, you can go to the code base, you can skim through the code, you know, if you want to spend a Saturday night sometime, and you can understand, you know, how are we getting these measurements? How do we know, you know, what are the assumptions made when we measure whether, say, BitTorrent is being blocked or throttled, right? And understanding that means that an action taken in response to that can be incredibly precise and very effective. And then, you know, finally putting all of the data that is collected from these tests, and there are about 200,000 tests run a day globally, putting all of that into the public domain so that not only, you know, you and me and a number of people in a closed room can look at this data and verify it, but if someone else, some brilliant graduate student, you know, say in Fiji, wants to look at it and finds a bug in the code or finds, you know, some novel way to use the data, they can do that too. And actually, you know, the state of the art in terms of understanding the internet, in terms of understanding networks, can move forward in time with the state of regulation. So next slide. So just a quick, you know, I want to clarify this because, you know, especially when we're talking about consumer rights, when we're talking about human rights, privacy matters, and we believe this very strongly. To be very clear, you know, this means that we can't collect personal data and put it in the public domain. That is an absolute. So we have to find creative ways to get around that, and the way that MLAB does that very quickly, and there may be other models, but the MLAB model is to use active tests, which mean that there's a stream of synthetic predetermined data that goes between a user testing and a server. And in each case of an individual test, that stream is the same. So I run this test now, you run it in 2 years, that stream of data will be the same. And what is measured is the reaction of the network. And so you can tell the network conditions by the way that it reacts to this synthetic stream. We collect that and IP address, and all of that is put in the public domain, but nothing that says anything about individual users. And that's an important part, you know, balancing privacy with verifiability and making sure that nothing that's out there can harm anyone. So moving forward. And then just this is my closing slide. So you see here, you know, I hope that on the screen over here you can see it better than I can, but a map that is, you know, what I'm doing here is just showing the possibilities for this kind of global data. So we did a quick visualization. Some of our research scientists looked at the data, and this is just download throughput speed, you see that the size of the bubble represents the speed achieved, I believe. Actually, I don't remember the screenshot I took, and I can't read it. But in any event, you go measurementlab.net, and you can play with a number of these visualizations. And this is showing that, you know, this open and very technical data can be distilled and visualized and made real for consumers, for people who didn't study engineering, you know, such as myself, and that this can actually, you know, have meaning across a number of constituencies. And I think I just want to close by sort of positioning this as a real tangible metaphor for the kind of multi-stakeholder, that term again, that this collaborative internet stewardship, right? That everyone who is a stakeholder in this process needs to collaborate, because this is not a regulatory issue solely. This is a technical issue. This is a consumer rights issue. And we're talking about a nervous system that now connects humans across the world. We need to work together from a clear set of principles and a clear set of data. So I'll close with that. Thanks a lot. Please come find me if you're interested in Measurement Lab or measurement.
Thank you very much indeed. The only regret that I have is that we're not going to have too much time for questions at the end of all of this, but I hope that you'll collect our business cards and go away and email us or catch us at the lunch break to talk some more. So next we have Ms. Pramila Kumar, who's currently a consumer advocate. She's had a distinguished career as a trade and investment facilitator, environmentalist, teacher educator, and a secondary school teacher. Pramila heads the Consumer Council of Fiji, which is the only leading independent consumer organisation in Fiji, tasked with the responsibility of protecting the rights and interests of consumers. She covers a range of issues such as utilities, financial services, unfair commercial practices, ICT, the aviation sector, and general consumer products and services. Thank you very much, Pramila.
It is my pleasure to address this forum today. I thank Consumers International for this invite. I'd like to make comments in few areas based on my experience in complaints handling. You have heard that there are there are 8 consumer rights, but my focus would be on consumer redress. The reason why I would like to do that, you know, in a global setting as we are experiencing in this particular venue, the grassroots issues are not generally spoken, because that grassroots issues are drowned by political issues, the push and the pull factor. So I would like to bring in the grassroots perspective, which really seems far removed at the global level. But again, at the global level, when policies are made or norms are set, these norms are translated at the national level and then through regulations, etc., and then it gets implemented. So the global idea or general idea is that whatever norms are set at the global level will definitely benefit the end user. But the question is, does it really benefit the end user? Now, the first question I would like to pose here is why consumers need protection in the ICT area. And to me, the answer is it's simply because of imbalance in power as well as imbalance in technical knowledge, which puts consumers in a very disadvantaged position. And for that reason, consumers need protection. Consumers, when they're using internet, they would like to have their privacy respected, and they would like to use the internet freely without the fear of cybercrime. Now, when we handle complaints in our office, there are 2 types of complaints. One is directly linked to the ISPs. In other words, you signed up with an ISP, and therefore the issues associated with it. But the second one is indirect, where you have not subscribed to an ISP, but there are service providers who are dependent on ISP. In other words, services that are dependent on internet. For example, airlines. When you check in, if the internet is down, then there is a very long queue and people have to stand in that queue, and you get frustrated. Sometimes you miss your flight, or if the flight is delayed, then obviously the people who are waiting for you at the other end, and if it's a distance issue, they have made a travel, so they put in a claim. And when you take this claim to the airlines, they would like to treat internet disruption as unforeseen circumstances. So there are further issues associated with that. The fact that I generally handle a lot of complaints in our office, I can say that ICT sector is no different to the financial sector. When one looks at consumer grievances, issues are similar, that is, information not in simple language, important details are hidden within small prints, difficult to compare rates, misleading advertisement, exit or termination fees, unfair contract terms. However, what is different when we compare it with financial services is that broadband speeds are unsubstantiated. And sometimes consumers are billed for full services, although internet is down for weeks. But again, if you look at the financial services, it was always unregulated, and the general perception was that let the invisible hand do its work, and human hands should not interfere. I mean, the regulator should not interfere, leave it to the market forces. But we have seen what happened with the global crisis. We've seen that the number of countries who had to step in and they had to protect the consumers, and therefore they had come up with consumer financial protection regulations. I would like to share a case study where we had to deal with a public outcry when Fiji's only fixed line ISP tried to use bullying tactics to migrate its thousands of subscribers to new rates and packages. We were very nice to the ISP. We started writing to them, highlighting some of the laws that they were breaching, including the consumer rights and why consumers need to be protected. As many letters we wrote, they just ignored our letters. And it was really frustrating because on one hand, the consumers were knocking on our door, and on the other hand, we were knocking on the ISP's door. But there was no response. So in that situation, the council opted for naming and shaming strategy to stop the ISP from abusing consumer rights. What we did, we had to come up with a good media strategy. First, we looked at the government policy on broadband and what government's intention were or vision was. So we started doing making some public statements where we used the broadband policy, and in particular, where the government's policy talked about availability, affordability, and capacity to use. So we were safe from the government perspective that we were in the same boat. Then we had to use another strategy, and that is looking at the competition laws, because we do have competition authority and other regulators that is there to protect consumer rights. And we pointed out several parts of the legislation which this ISP was breaching, and yet these regulators were not standing up and literally doing their job. So and a lot of we literally put a lot of pressure on the ISP, and the media was on our side. So ultimately the regulator had to call the two parties together, that is the ISP and the Consumer Council, and we sat across the table and we highlighted what were some of the issues. And one of the key issues that we felt was that with the new package, consumers were losing out on 4 gigabytes of data. Although they were saying that, you know, we're going to give you high speed, but only 1 gigabyte of data. But the question here again was that the Commerce Commission had already had placed the wholesale bandwidth prices under price control. So we expected a reduction in the price. And so that did not happen. We also argued that why broadband plans were based on speeds which they could not guarantee. Why ISP informed its customers that if they did not convert to the new rates and they had stipulated the date, subscribers will automatically be converted to a new plan. And yet they were going to penalize the consumers by removing the email addresses. So we were saying that's double victimization, because one is, yeah, you have, without the consumer's approval, you have converted them. But again, if you did convert them, then why are you removing the email addresses? We also argued why expensive reloads, which consumers buy, could not be carried forward to the next month, because they said, if you buy these expensive reloads, at the end of the month, you lose them. So the thinking was more on use it or lose it. And we also argued why ISP was penalizing consumers who wish to switch to other ISPs. And here in the contract, what they said was that if you switch to another ISP, which is actually a breach of competition law, and they said that, you know, you will forfeit the security deposit. And that was unacceptable, because security deposit has a stated purpose. So we had highlighted that, and after continuous pressure, we succeeded, where the ISP had to redraft a new contract, and they offered 5 gigabytes data cap instead of 1 gigabyte at high speed, and allowed consumers to carry forward reloads for another 30 days. So that was our success story. But the success did not come without a big fight. It must be noted that ISP publicly stated during these fights that their contracts are benchmarked against ISP service provided worldwide that follows the global norm. And to me, that was shocking. And I'm questioning, if that is so, then we need a minimum guideline to ensure consumer rights are not abused by ISPs. And besides handling complaints, we are also engaged with Consumers International in a number of campaigns. And we are calling on the ISPs to provide standard disclosure statement so that the consumers will be able to know the speed, the reliability, the price, and other details of broadband internet that is provided. We are also engaged in another campaign. We call it Don't Lock Me In. And the idea is to dismantle barriers created by ISPs. So in conclusion, ladies and gentlemen, I would like to say that consumer organizations do play a very important role. We assist in identifying emerging issues that happens on the ground, and that is through consumer complaints. And at the same time, we are also able to provide assessment of policies that are developed by the government, which may be based on international norms, to gauge whether these policies are prone to implementation deficit, and if it is, that what needs to be done. So thank you for listening.
Thank you very much, Pramila. And now we have a very welcome contribution from the supply side of the equation. Michele Bilavite has worked since 2002 in the Public and Regulatory Affairs Division of Telecom Italia. Based in Brussels, he chairs the Digital Society Working Group of ETNO, which is the European Public Telecommunications Network Operators Association, and he's also an alternate board member. He holds a degree in political science from the University of Pavia, with a major in European political organization, and has done postgraduate training at the College of Europe. Michele.
Thank you very much. I'll try to be as brief as possible to leave some space to the debate. I just wanted to raise a couple of points from the perspective of the European Telecom Operators Association. What we have in the EU is a very advanced legal framework in terms of consumer protection. So what we're working on today as telecom operators in the European Union is more trying to understand what will be the future challenges of consumer protection in the internet market, rather than concentrating on the implementation of the current laws of consumer protection, because this is already a very developed part of the EU. Of the EU legislation. In the European Union, we do have sectoral directives regulating the telecom sector. One of them is the Universal Service Directive, which provides for all the legal provisions relating to contracts between consumers and telecom operators and to the rights of citizens to access content, services and applications. And on top of that, we've got a broader framework for consumer rights protection, which provides for legal tools such as alternative dispute resolution, class action, collective redress, empowerment of sectoral independent authorities to enforce consumer protection law. A very interesting area which is under review in the EU now is that concerning data protection and data privacy, which relates more to the defense of consumer rights in the online world rather than simply looking at the relationship of the consumer with the telecom operators in terms of broadband connection. Now, if we look at the broadband market today from the perspective of consumer protection, the question we're asking ourselves as telecom operators, as broadband providers, as ISPs in the EU, are the following. How is the broadband market developing? How will be the future broadband market? What kind of rights will need to be discussed in the public policy debate? Will there be a right to the quality of online services which looks beyond the quality of connectivity? How will the protection of these rights match with the future dynamics of market development? And finally, if I can make a very quick conclusion, if we look at how the internet has developed in the last 15, 20 years, we can see that it's mainly been driven by market and private companies, which sometimes have conflicting interests. So what we're trying to investigate today is to what extent will these conflicting interests in the internet sphere impact the multi-level protection of multiple rights by multiple authorities in the member states of the European Union. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much, Michele. We've just noticed that the transcript has stopped, so is there anything that can be done about that at the technical end? It's only important if there are remote participants following, and I'm not sure whether there are. In any case, we'll move on to our final panelist, and I think we will extend just a few minutes after 12:30 because we did start late after all, so that we will have time for a couple of questions at the end. Professor S.C. Sahasrabude is director of the Dhirubhai Ambani Institute of Information and Communication Technology in Gandhinagar and director of GTL Limited, Bombay. He's also a member of the governing body of the Consumer Education and Research Society, recently working on Consumers International's project, Holding Broadband Service Providers to Account. He has a doctorate in communication and signal processing from Leningrad University of the former USSR, and his fields of interest include communications, signal and image processing, microprocessor applications, and expert systems. He's published widely, supervised over 12 theses, and received several awards. He's a fellow of the IEEE and of the IETE. So thank you very much, Professor.
Thank you very much, Jeremy. Good afternoon, everyone. And strangely, I seem to be following in footsteps of Jeremy. I went to Kuala Lumpur last time. This time I managed to lose my baggage when I came to Baku. So if you find me rather shabbily dressed today, this is all I had. Coming to the topic for today's presentation, if you can show us the first slide. It's on four issues: internet, ISP, the client, that is you and I, and also the quality of service, which is the primary objective why we've come here. Can you show the next slide? I'll finish in 5 minutes, because that's the tail end of the presentation. We need not discuss about the internet except to mention that it's a very loosely coupled organization and a very loosely coupled network, so there is no centralized control, and that makes it very different from most other organizations that you will see. And it is very important because it is livelihood for a large number of people and so many other things. So access to internet is not a trivial matter at all. And so we come to the last point in the first slide that we had, the question of quality of service. if you can show us the next slide. Quality of service, of course, is a very elusive thing. You look at it from the engineering perspective. You can also look at it from a very subjective perspective. And you can also see that it's something which changes very randomly because of the very nature of the internet. I must admit that the engineers have studied it for a very long time as to what the quality of service, you know, you should get and you can get on the internet. And it has been essentially irrespective of the consumer finally, you know, who gets connected to the ISP. They were really bothered as to how to improve the performance of the internet to deliver better quality, purely from an engineering sense. And the engineers, and you may say somewhat rather foolishly, seem to think that all people will play fair. And that usually doesn't happen in life. And I can call them foolish because I belong to the tribe myself. And they address the issue not only from the ISP to the consumer, but also the entire internet. So that's where, you know, somewhere you will see the weakening. If you can show us the next slide, I think there's a question that what is the best that you can do on behalf of the consumer is the kind of question that that we need to look at. You will find that my presentation will have many points in common with what was said earlier by panelist Meredith, because she looked at it purely from the amount of data that you can move around. So I would ask a couple of questions and try and see if we can give them answers. So if you can get us the next slide. Is the access speed very important? Because a lot of people seem to focus, for some reason or other, only on the speed at which the access is provided to you. It is important, yes. And maybe it is not all important, but it is important. Can it be measured? As an engineer, I believe that the access speed can be measured. The more important question is, can the consumer understand this measurement? And there I would say it's difficult for an ordinary consumer to be able to understand what that measurement means. We had a comment in the morning from the representative from Fiji saying that when they went to talk to consumers about the broadband and getting them involved in the working, most people said, what is broadband? So if that is the level of understanding that a consumer has, if I gave him an engineering measurement of access speed, I don't think he would want to even look at it. So that's really difficult. And particularly, you know, being a random value, it will be presented in terms of tables, charts, and things of that kind, which an ordinary consumer who just wants to use the internet for his work and livelihood will not be able to work at. So let's go and see as to which way the quality of service, you know, that will affect him, if you can show us. The actual quality of service depends on multiple factors. Multiple factors include, the speed itself, the packet loss rate, the different jitters that you encounter when you receive packets, and also, surprisingly, it depends on application. So it's not only the raw data rate that you get, which will ultimately determine the quality of service that you are getting, but it will also depend. For example, if you are making a telephone call on using internet, then the packet jitters and packet delays are far more objectionable than if you're downloading a large type of file. So with the same set of parameters that one engineer can measure, depending on the application, the quality of service will change. And there are a lot of things that the ISP can do to improve your quality of service, not just buried in the set of numbers. So hopefully that that can be done. We need a measurement not just of access speed, but the whole quality of service that a consumer gets. And I think that's where a much greater amount of work that has to be done, particularly by the engineering community like the MLab and others, to be able to give a meaningful answer to the consumer as to what quality of service he is actually getting, and not bury them in the set of numbers that we can do. one of the issues that I had in mind is it possible, and that's a question perhaps partly I'm addressing to my co-panelist, Meredith, that the quality of service application can be created which will run on the consumer's machine so that there are no issues of the remaining part of the internet, and it just measures the kind of quality that he gets day on day after day and convert it from an engineering measurement into something which is, let's say, my grandmother would have followed. If that can be done, then you know you will have something which is a little undisputable data and undisputable measurement, hopefully stand the test in the court of law. So that's you know one thing that I had a suggestion to come up with. The second thing is, if you can show us the next slide. Most people, consumers, do not really understand the SLA that they sign. If they can't understand what is broadband, you certainly don't expect them to understand what the SLA says. There's a huge lot of, you know, fine print there, as was mentioned earlier. And the question that I put now is to, perhaps at the moment, to Jeremy, is it not possible to come up with a model SLA, or at least a template for it, so that, you know, the consumer can at least ask, the SLA that you are making me sign, how does it run in terms of the model SLA which the Consumer International has created, or another body has created which is widely acceptable? Is it possible that all SLAs of all ISPs are available in the public domain, so that the experts can study it and point out where the consumer has to be careful, where it is likely to be very unfair to the kind of service that he's going to get? Another issue, you know, which seemed to be that the end of the month, you get a bill from the ISP, and it does not reveal, as a matter of fact, it doesn't reveal anything except the amount that you have to pay to him. Can we design a standard content design of the bill as to the bill must contain the following information? Like, you know, the telephone operator is now required to give all the list of all the calls and the duration for which, you know, the call was made to be provided along with the bill. Now, perhaps a similar content can be designed for the bill which the ISP service provider must give, so that, you know, if not all, at least some of the consumers can can make meaning out of it. The next one, complaints and redress. I think I can skip this because about the regulator there was a whole lot of things said. The major issue is, can we have access to information which a regulator in principle can have? Because the best thing that an ISP can do, if you go on complaining that the quality of service that you gave was not good, said it is not in my domain, it happened somewhere else, so sorry, I'm not responsible. But the regulator in principle could have access to all the events that happened on the internet and may be able to say, sorry, it did not happen somewhere else, it actually happened in your part of the network. And of course, the issue of power of regulators, which has been which has been already talked of today. If you don't give the regulators the teeth that they need, then they might as well not be there. My last concluding slide is about not what at the moment is happening, but the problem that is in the waiting. The fixed broadband access is still a very reasonable and a very friendly environment for the engineers. It's stable. You can carry out measurements. You can carry out measurements repeatedly. As it was said, that you can carry out measurements perhaps every few milliseconds, and things don't change. But the mobile access is certainly there. The 3G, 4G will come whether we like it or we don't. I expect that to be a dominant access, not as in Africa because the wireline is not there, but even in Europe because people want to be mobile. The younger generation perhaps would not have much patience with connecting to the internet on a wireline from a fixed position. And that is going to create two major problems which we are not even looking at. I do not know whether there is an advanced group at MLAB which is looking at these issues because they are very different. Spectrum is very expensive, so no ISP is going to give you spectrum if he need not give. If he can hide, he will definitely not give you the spectrum. The wireless link which you use for mobile, IP, internet, is extremely unpredictable. It changes its characters every few milliseconds. So if you cannot capture transactions that happen there, also looking at the quality of access as it existed on the wireless link at that moment, you cannot prove anything against the ISP as to why the service given to you was not good. So that's a problem which is a big one, which is around the corner. It will definitely come to you. And and I think we should start at least looking at what could be the response from the community to protect the consumer, who will definitely shift to the new mode of operations. The last slide is there for references. Actually, I got involved in this in the, as is put in the first reference, because, you know, I did, me and my team actually did some contribution to that. And then there are some couple of very interesting reports in which you'll get a lot of insight into what happens on the internet access. I think my presentation has a few additional slides, but I think they can be transferred. They need not be looked at. So last slide is thank you. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much indeed, Professor. And I'm sure you'll all agree, it's been a very diverse panel with expertise across a whole range of different areas, and yet we're all on the same page when it comes to the importance of protecting the rights of broadband consumers. And there's a lot of scope for us to collaborate on joint projects to that end. So before we do close, and I'm sorry for keeping you a few minutes late, are there any questions from the floor or from the remote participants? There were, in fact, a couple of questions in that last presentation which were back to the panel. So perhaps we'll just close by briefly. I think there was a question about application level quality of service for the consumer. Do you think, do you want to address that?
Yeah, should I just begin? Okay, I'm between you and lunch, so a number of these questions can be answered on the measurementlab.net website. You talked about an application running on the consumer's device measuring, I think it was application level performance was what you were asking. Yes, we actually, if you go to the website, click test my internet, and you can run a number of tests. However, you're not going, if I understand your question correctly, in order to get data that, you know, you talked about having kind of legal standing for this data, you also need to make sure that it is open, and that you know, this sort of model I presented is enforced, because if you present numbers that people can't verify, it's much harder to stand behind them. I would also say that application needs to, you know, it needs to reach testing servers in the public internet. So it can't, you know, there isn't a possibility of simply downloading a client that doesn't reach out to the internet and understanding application performance, because you need to understand, you know, there are a number of variables at every step along the path. So those need to be accounted for and understood when you're talking about performance.
Yeah, you know, I had a slightly different thing in mind. I'm really talking of a consumer as to what quality of service he gets. And when I said it's application dependent, one is of course a question of application that runs on his machine, because that's in the best location to capture all the data transactions that can take place at that point.
Yeah, the measurement lab tests run from the user's client from their machine to a measurement lab server. So they're all user facing. And a user opts in to run the test. The test then sends a stream of data between the machine, the client, and the measurement lab server, and it's the network's reaction to that stream of data from the device to the server that is measured. So we measure everything from, you know, TCP receiver window size, which can, you know, problems with the receiver window can mimic things like data throttling, to you know, issues at every AS on the way to the measurement lab server. So we with every test, 150 over 150 variables are collected that span that path. We can talk more technically about it afterwards.
I think we should perhaps
a
little
please
bit
please eat.
So thank you very much for your patience, and you did make another couple of suggestions, Professor, about standard model SLAs and build designs. I think those are very valuable suggestions. So I'll take those up within CI, and we can see what we can do about that. So we've already lost some people from the room due to the lure of lunch, so I think that's a signal that it's time to wrap up. Let's thank the panelists very much for their valuable contributions to this session.